Welcome to the course on advanced topics in coding theory. It's always a pleasure to see so many people, and special thanks to our returning participants. Okay, so I'm going to talk about decoding of linear block codes. So what we saw in lecture 2 was the error, whether there is an error or not, that can be detected using syndrome. We saw that syndrome is dependent on error pattern, right? So from the syndrome we can find out whether an error has happened or not. And then what you saw was an example where we tried to do error correction. What we did was we enumerated all possible solutions of those equations, syndrome equations, and we said one of those 16 solutions was most likely solution. And that's how we did the decoding. Now I'm going to talk about a general method for decoding of these linear block codes. So the problem that we are looking at, we have an NK linear block codes, okay, and we are considering binary linear block codes. We are considering that these, our data is binary, which is encoded using these binary codes. It passes through a binary symmetric channel, so the output is also binary. Now we need to find out of those 2n different possibilities, we need to partition these 2n different possible outcomes into clusters of total 2k clusters, where in each cluster there should be only one code word associated with that. So we need to find a general method of partitioning these 2 raised to power n possible vectors into 2k such disjoint clusters, where there is only one code word associated with each code word. And our decoding will be as follows. So once we receive a code word, we will try to see which cluster it belongs to. And since we know there is only one code word associated with that cluster, we will map that to that particular code word. And this is minimum distance decoding. Think of it, we have a space of a real Rn, and we have these 2k different clusters there. You receive a sequence. Now you try to find out which is the closest code word to that particular receive sequence. So this is in gist we are going to talk about now. So as I said, we are considering a receive sequence over a binary symmetric channel. So we have total 2^n possible outcomes. Now any decoding schemes that we use as a receiver, our objective is to partition this 2n possible receive sequence into 2k disjoint subsets. Why disjoint subsets? Because we don't want any confusion. So we should be able to, there should be one code word associated with this one such partition. So we want to partition these 2^n possible receive vectors into 2k disjoint subsets. I'm calling them D1, D2, D2k, such that the code word VI is contained in subset DI. So there is one code word associated with each of these partitions. And this partition is based on linear structure of the block code. So we are going to use the linearity property of linear block codes. So let us denote the code words by V1, V2, V3, V2^k. So let these be the 2k code words, where our first code word V1 is a all zero code word. Remember, all zero code word is a valid code word for a linear block code. Now we form an array of vectors from vector space Vn. So basically we have these n tuples, and each of them can take value 0 or 1. So total we have 2^n such tuples. Now we want to arrange them as follows. Arrange the 2k code words as the top row of this array, with all zero vector as the first element. So what we are going to do is, I'm going to arrange all these 2k 2^n possibilities into a table, which will have 2k columns, okay, where each column will correspond to only one code word. So if I can arrange my 2^n such code words in such a table, then I know that since each column belongs to only one code word, I should be able to decode. So whenever I receive a particular sequence, I know which code word it belongs to, correct? So I am trying to create that table. I am trying to arrange this 2^n possible n tuples into a table which has 2k different columns. So first row of such table will consist of all the 2k code words where the first, the leftmost column, the first column is corresponding to all 0 code word. Now let us assume that we have constructed j -1 rows of such an array. Then how do I construct the jth array? So choose a vector ej which is from vector space Vn, which is basically an n tuple which has not occurred previously. So first row is all code words. First row, first column is all 0 code word. Now let's say I have constructed up to j minus 1. Then how should I create jth row? I pick up an n tuple which doesn't appear in any of the previous j minus 1 rows. Okay. So choose a vector from vector space Vn which is not there in previous j minus 1 rows. Now form the jth row by adding that vector ej to each of the code words in the top row and placing ej plus vi under vi. So what I am doing is something like this. So my first row is all code words. First row, first column is all 0 code word. Now let's say I want to create this third row. So I will pick E3 such that E3 doesn't appear in any of the first two rows. Okay. Now to construct this third row, what I am going to do is I am going to add E3 to all these code words. So E3 plus V1 is 0, I mean E3 plus V1 is E3, E3 plus V2 is E3 plus V2, E3 plus VI is E3 plus VI. So I add this E3 to these code words and put this new n tuple in the same column as the code word VI. So that's what I am saying here, that form the jth row by adding EJ to each code word VI in the top row and placing EJ plus VI under VI. Is this clear? How we are creating this rows of this array? Continue till all the vectors, that means all 2^n possible vectors have been placed in this array. Is this clear? Okay. Now this array is known as standard array. Now let us see some properties of this standard array. So standard array will be something like this. It will have 2^k columns and how many rows? 2^n-k. So let us consider a 6-3 linear block code whose generator matrix is given by this. Now I have written the standard array for this particular code. Now what is the procedure? So go back here. The generator matrix is given. Can you find out what would be the set of code words? can you find out all 2k code words? You take all k 2k tuples, so 0, 0, this is 6, 3, right? So there are 3 tuple, 0, 0, 0, 2, 0, 0, sorry, 2, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, like that you take all 8 possible U's and multiply it by G, because my code word V is U times G, correct? So you will get these 2k different code words. Now what I have done here is, since my all the 8 code words were not fitting in the same slide, I just put them over 2 slides. So this is my all 0 code word, and then I had this V2, V3, V4 and V5, V6, V7, V8. So these are my 8 code words corresponding to this 6-3 linear code whose generator matrix I showed you in the previous slide. Next, I need to create row number 2 of this standard array. Now what is the procedure? You pick up an error vector, pick up an n tuple which has not occurred before. Now, so let's start first with all weight 1 tuples, right? So you can see, if you look at the code word, this is all 0 code word, this has weight 3, weight 3, weight 3, this is weight 4, weight 4, weight 4, weight 3. So you can see weight 1 and weight 2 do not appear in the list of code words. So let us now start first with weight 1 tuple. So I took 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. That's my E2. Now what is the entry here? This is this vector plus V2. And this addition is done modulo 2. Okay? So 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 plus 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0 will be 1, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. And I place this new vector in the same column as V2. What is the entry in V4? You add this plus this. So you can see 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 plus 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1 will be 1 plus 1 is 0, modulo 2, and then 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. This I do for all these elements. Now again note, none of these have weight like under V8, V7, V6, V5, all these have weight 3, 3, 5, 4. Similarly, this has weight 4, weight 2, weight 2. We still don't have other weight 1 patterns here. So I choose another weight 1 pattern, which is 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. And then I add this to this, add this vector to V3, add this vector to V4, and that's how I create this row number 3. How do I create row number 4? Again, this vector didn't appear. You can check, basically 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0 hasn't appeared in any of the first 3 rows. You can see 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0 is not there. Okay? So I choose this, and then this entry under this column will be this error vector plus V2, which is given by this. Similarly, entry under this is this plus this. So you continue doing that until all possible code words, all possible receive sequences have been enumerated. So in this case, the all possible sequences will be 2 raised to power 6, right? Which is basically 64 possible, and there are 8 columns, so there are 8 rows. So this is, this standard array is 8 cross 8 dimension in for this particular example. Okay. Now what we have done is, we have partitioned our 64 possible receive sequences into 8 columns, where in each of these columns there is one code word associated with it. If you look at this particular, this is this error vector plus 0 vector p1, this is error vector plus v2, this is error vector plus v3. So if you look at each of these columns, there is one code word associated with it. So you can think of it as this all possible receive sequence, you have now partitioned them into disjoint sets, where each set has only one particular code word associated with it. Okay. Is the construction of standard array clear? Now let us prove some properties of the standard array. Yes.
So is it compulsory to take the 1000?
Okay. A very good question. A very good question. Here when I started doing this, right, you have plenty of options because only 8 possible n tuples were used. But I started with weight 1 pattern. Why? I will answer that in a little while. There is a reason why I chose the minimum weight pattern as my entry in the first column. There is a reason behind it. I will come to that. We will see that, okay, if you want to answer right now, you know that syndrome depends only on the error pattern. So all these code words will have the same syndrome, okay, because this is error pattern E2, this is E2 plus V2. Will have the same syndrome because V2 H transpose will be 0. Similarly, this same syndrome. So if you recall in the last lecture, we enumerated for the 7-4 code, we enumerated 16 solutions. Similarly, for this 6-3 code, there are 8 solutions for each syndrome. So what you see here is the 8 solutions for belonging to a particular syndrome. So if you get a particular syndrome, you know these are the solutions. And the reason I chose weight 1 or the minimum weight pattern as my first column is because we just saw that maximum likelihood rule for binary symmetric channel is you choose a code word which has minimum Hamming distance from the received vector. Correct? So this, by choosing the minimum error pattern as the leader of this row, we are ensuring that this is the most likely error pattern. And that's why when we had so many options here, Yaswinder, that's a very nice question. That's the reason we chose the minimum weight pattern as our leader. Because this is, if you look at this particular row, this is weight 1, weight 4, weight 2, weight 2, weight 3, weight 3, weight 5, weight 4. Now out of these, it's more likely that one bit got flipped rather than two bits getting flipped or three bits getting flipped, right? And that's why when we started creating this, we started with the lowest weight pattern which has not occurred before. I'm sorry.
All have one way, right?
That's fine. But these,
huh? We want to organize.
No, we can. We have no issues with if you want to make this one first element here.
Yeah.
There's no problem because each one of these will have separate syndrome, different syndrome. Okay. So we have no issue with that. Except that among the receive sequence which have the same syndrome, we want to choose the one which has minimum error weight. We want to make it as the leader of the this. We call this row as coset, and the first entry of this coset is called coset leader. So we want to make the coset leader as error pattern which has minimum Hamming weight.
One more.
Yes, sure.
After exhausting all the weight 1 error vector,
right,
we go for weight 2 error vector.
That's correct. So that's right.
There we randomly choose some error vector, 4 0 1.
Okay. So what we need to do is, we need to choose an error pattern which has not happened before. Okay. Now, so if you look at this particular, just a minute, if you look at this particular case, there were actually two error patterns of weight 2. One was this 100100, another was 010010. These were the two patterns which haven't appeared before, okay, and both are weight 2. Now the question is, which one should be the coset leader? So you can just toss, because it's equally likely that randomly these two bits getting flipped or these two bits getting flipped. So you can choose any one of them as coset leader.
Last
year. Yeah, there are, in fact, there are three here, that's right. This 001001 010010, and this. So v1 v5 and v6, they all have weight 2 Hamming weight. So any one of them could have been the coset leader. So the first property which we are going to show is, we want to show that every vector in Vn appears exactly once in the standard array, because we don't want repetition, right? Now this follows from rule of construction, rule of standard array, and we prove this by contradiction. Now what is proved by contradiction? So we say that, we contradict this statement, we say that there are two elements which are same in the standard array, and then we will find out that that's not possible. Okay, so let's just pull the standard array form that we had. Let's say this, let's say two elements are same, you just name them two elements, just okay, e2 plus let's say v1 is same as let's say e6 plus v3. Okay. Now, I can write this as E6 is equal to E2 plus V1 plus V3. I add V3 both the sides, because its addition is binary, V3 plus V3 will be 0. So E6 is E2 plus V1 plus V3, correct? What is V1 plus V3? Another code word. Why? Because it's a linear combination of two. So we know the property of linear block code, that sum of two code word is a valid code word. So this is E2 plus, let's call it V1 dash, let's say. Now, I wrote E6 as E2 plus V1 dash, where V1 dash is a valid code word. Where does E2 plus V1 dash appears? Second row. Because second row has E2 plus some code word added. So what mistake did I do? I picked up, I contradicted, because I'm supposed to choose an error vector which has not happened before. I have not done that. I chose E6 as V2 plus V dash. So I am contradicting actually the construction of standard array. So what I showed was, then it's not possible to have two elements repeated in the standard array. Okay. So that's what I meant. This follows from the construction rule of standard array. Because standard array construction says you have to pick a error pattern which has not appeared previously in j minus 1 rows. What I did here was, for the sixth row, I picked up a pattern which appeared in row 2, and I'm not allowed to do that. Okay, hence it cannot happen that two elements of this standard array are same. So each element, so I have proved each vector appears exactly once in the standard array. No two vectors in the same row of the standard array are identical. This is clear because essentially what are the elements of each row? E2 plus V2, E2 plus V3, and so none of them are basically. This follows from the fact that all code words are distinct. So if all code words are distinct, we would not have E2 plus V2 same as E2 plus some V dash, right? So this follows from the fact that all code words are distinct. Next. Each row is called a coset. Each row of this standard array is called a coset, and they are exactly 2 raised to power n minus k coset. The first element of each coset is called coset leader. Now, technically, any element in a coset can be the coset leader, but we choose normally the minimum Hamming weight coset as a coset leader. Now, this does not change the elements of the coset, it just changes the order. What do I mean by that? Let's go back to our standard array. Okay, here. Now, let us look. Instead of E3, if I make, let's say, E3 plus VEI as my coset leader, what is going to change? This E3 plus VI, which was earlier under VI, will now come under V1. Now, what will be the entry here? This will be E3 plus VI plus V2. What is VI plus V2? Another code word. What will be entry under this? E3 plus VI plus VI, that is E3. So, you can see that the elements are same, it's just that the order has been changed. Okay. So, we can technically choose any one of them as a coset leader, but for the reason I mentioned, we try to keep the lowest Hamming weight pattern as our coset leader. Now, all 2k elements of the coset have the same syndrome as their coset leader. This is easy to see. Why? Because syndrome is given by S is. So, what are the elements of a particular coset? They are of the form EJ. Jth row will have some error pattern EJ plus some code word VI H transpose. Now, if we do this, this can be written as EJ H transpose plus VI H transpose. Since VI is a valid code word, VI H transpose will be 0. So, this will just depend on EJ H transpose. And note that, so it does not depend on what VI is. So, all the elements of a coset will have the same syndrome. And as I said earlier, the 2k elements, coset elements, which have the same syndrome, they are actually the 2k solutions of the syndrome equation. In the last lecture, we enumerated for a 7-4 code. We enumerated 16 possible solutions. These solutions are exactly the elements of a row to which that particular syndrome is pointing. And another interesting thing is, each of these 2 raised to power n minus k coset leaders, they have a different syndrome. Why? Because first row corresponds to basically all 0, first coset leader is 0. In the second case, coset leader is E2, E3, E4, E5. So, each row has a different coset leader, you can say. So, that is why their syndrome is this EJ is different for each row. So, each row will have a different syndrome. So, you can see that each of these 2 n minus k coset leader corresponds to different syndrome. So, there is a 1-to-1 correspondence between a coset leader and the syndrome. Now, look at the jth column of the standard array. If you go back, any, let us say, ith column I am looking here, what are the elements here? Vi, e2 plus vi, e3 plus vi, e4 plus vi, e2 raised to power n minus k plus vi. So, that is the column under vi. So, the jth column of the standard array contains exactly one code word, and what is that code word? Vj. So, we have accomplished our task of partitioning these 2 to the power n possible code words into 2k disjoint sets. Now, if r belongs, if the received sequence belongs to column dj, then r is decoded as code word vj. Now, if vj is a transmitted code word and the error pattern is a coset leader, let us call it ei, then what is the received sequence? The received sequence is vj, which is a transmitted code word, plus the error pattern, which is ei. Now, vj plus ei will lie in jth column. Right, and you will decode that vj was transmitted. So, in other words, what I am saying is, if the error pattern is coset leader, you will not make decoding error. If the error pattern is a coset leader, you will always correctly decode. Why you will correctly decode? Because receive sequence will be vj plus ei, and we have seen that jth column contains elements of the form vj plus ei. So, the code word associated with jth column is vj. So, you would not make any mistake.
Sir,
yes?
Each column will be a partition.
Right. Each column is a partition, absolutely right. Yes. Yes.
Yes. Now, we see that if we observe the last row,
right,
we see that the minimum Hamming distance between the first element of the first row,
right,
last row first element is 2.
You mean this one and this one?
First, V1 and the last element.
Last element is V8.
No. V1 and the last element in first column.
Last element in the second column.
0, 0, 0.
Which one do you want? Do you want this one or this one?
First
column, or okay, tell me first the column number.
Column number 1.
Okay.
Row first element is V1.
Column number 1, first element is all 0 code word.
Yes. Last element is 100, 100
in the same code.
Yes. 100, 100. That's yes.
Yes. Now we are decoding based on minimum Hamming distance principle, right?
Right.
We see the second element in the last row.
Second element in the rather it is the V5,
yes.
fifth element.
That also has minimum Hamming distance of 2 with respect to V1.
It also has minimum distance, exactly, right.
So now we are making a mistake. We might have transmitted V1, and 2 errors might have happened, and we might have received that, but we are wrongly decoding it as V5.
Did I say that? Hold on for a minute. Let me come to that. We would not make an error when we, I said, if the coset leader, if the error is a coset leader, then you are not going to make an error. That was my statement. That if the error pattern is this, my statement was, if the error pattern is, if you go back here, if the error pattern is a coset leader, then your receive sequence will be of the form this. You agree? In the last row, it is some, let's say it's the ith row, the receive sequence will be Vj plus Ei. If the error pattern is 001, 001, you are not going to make a mistake. But if the error pattern is something else, you are going to make a mistake, right? So my statement is, please note I am saying if the error pattern is a coset leader, then whatever sequence that you receive will be correctly decoded. There is another problem, there is a problem with the last row, and again I do not want to jump, I will come to that. And the problem arises from the fact that you have noticed that there are multiple elements in that coset which have weight 2 pattern, and all of them are equally likely to happen. So I will come to that in a little while. So again I repeat, if the error pattern is a coset leader, then your receive sequence will be of the form this, and you would not make an error. However, if the error pattern is not a coset leader, then this will result in incorrect decoding. Why? Let's say the error pattern X is caused by the channel and it is in the lth coset under code word VI, which is non-zero code word. So X is, let's say, EL plus VI, because X lies in the lth coset, so the error pattern corresponding to that is EL, and it lies under code vector VI, which is non-zero. So X is EL plus VI. So let us say error pattern is X, which is not a coset leader, because coset leader is EL. Now what happens if error X has happened? My transmitted code word was VJ. So receive sequence will be VJ plus X. So this will be EL plus VI plus VJ. Now VI plus VJ is sum of two code words, which is another code word, valid code word. Let's call it VS. Now where does this R lies now? Corresponding to code word VS. Whereas what I transmitted was VJ. So note now, if the error pattern is not the coset leader, then you will do incorrect decoding, because I would think here that code word VS was transmitted, but actually what was transmitted was VJ. Therefore, decoding is correct if and only if the error pattern is a coset leader. So all the 2 raised to power n minus k coset leaders are correctable error patterns. Now let's come to the point that you were discussing. To minimize now, since our correctable error patterns are coset leaders, so let us choose the most likely error pattern as our coset leader. This is to minimize probability of error. And we saw in lecture 2 that maximum likelihood decoding rule for binary symmetric channels says that we should try to minimize the Hamming distance between the received code word and selected code word V, received sequence and the code word V. So to minimize probability of error, error patterns most likely to happen should be chosen as coset leaders. And for a binary symmetric channel, we know an error pattern of smaller weight is more likely than an error pattern of higher weight. So each coset leader should be chosen to be the vector of least weight from the available vectors. Okay. And that's the reason when we started creating the standard array, we purposefully chose first all weight 1 patterns, because we wanted to make the most likely error pattern as our coset leader. So this way the coset leader will have minimum weight in its coset. And this decoding is basically your ML decoding, because we are choosing the coset leader as the error pattern which has least Hamming distance, least Hamming weight. So it will have the least Hamming distance between the received code word, received sequence and the chosen code word V. So assume that received vector R is found in ith column and lth coset, then in this case R is decoded as Vi. So, R is EL plus Vi. Now, let us compute the Hamming distance between R and Vi. So, if we compute Hamming distance between R and Vi, what is Hamming distance between two code words? So, let us take an example. Let us say we have two code words. Let us say you have two n tuples. Let us call it A and B. Let us say 1 1 1 0 0 0 1 1 1 1 0. Let us say these are 2 6 tuples. And if I ask you to find the Hamming distance between these two, how will you find Hamming distance?
The number of positions their entry is respective.
So, in location 1, there is a difference? 1. This is same, this is same, this is same. There is a difference. So, there are 2. Now, same thing can be found by, if I add these two vectors and find out the weight. If I add these, wherever they are same, they will add up to 0, because in binary addition, 0 plus 0 is 0 and 1 plus 1 is 0. So, wherever they are same, they will add up to 0. So, only in those locations where they are differing, there will be 1. If I add A plus B, it will be 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0. And what is the weight of this A plus B row? This is 2. So, this is what I am saying here, that Hamming distance between R and Vi is nothing but Hamming weight. Hamming weight is defined as number of ones in that vector, basically. Hamming weight between R and Vi. Do you agree? Now, what is R? R we said is in the lth coset and ith column. So, code word corresponding to this is Vi and the error pattern corresponding to this is EL. So, R is EL plus Vi. Now, EL plus Vi, that is weight of EL. Now, let us look at some other code word and find out the distance between R and some other code word which is not Vi. So, let us consider distance between R and any other code word, let us call it Vj. So, again that can be given by weight of R plus Vj, and what is R? EL plus Vi. So, this becomes weight of EL plus Vi plus Vj. What is Vi plus Vj? That is another code word, let us call it Vs. Now, note, we chose our coset leader to be the one that has minimum Hamming weight. So, weight of EL will be less than equal to weight of EL plus Vs. So, our decoder, our minimum distance decoding will decode in favor of Vi, not Vj, right. So, the point I am trying to say is, since EL and EL plus Vs, they are both in the same coset, and since the coset leader is chosen in such a way that it has the minimum Hamming weight. So, we will have weight of EL to be less than equal to weight of EL plus Vs. So, it follows that distance between R and Vi is less than equal to distance between R and V, any other code word Vj. So, the minimum distance decoding to code word, ML decoder will decide in favor of Vi, not Vj. Yes, sure. So, what I am trying to show you is, if I have a receive vector which has coset leader as error pattern, and let us say my transmitted code word was Vi, I am trying to find out where will this code word be decoded at, if I consider minimum distance decoding. Because remember, the maximum likelihood decoder that we talked about for binary symmetric channel, we said we should choose a V such that Hamming distance between R and V is, so among all possible VI, we should choose a VI which will minimize the Hamming distance. So what I am trying to ask is, question is, if this is my receive sequence R and my transmitted code word is VI, minimum distance decoding or maximum likelihood decoding will decode in favor of VI and not any other code word. In other words, if my error pattern is coset leader, then I am going to do correct decoding. So what is the correct decoding in this case? Because error pattern is EL, coset leader, and this is transmit code word is VI, the correct decoding is deciding in favor of VI. Now I am going to show, what I have shown here is that Hamming distance between R and VI is less than equal to Hamming distance between R and any other code word which is not VI. So my decoder will always decide in favor of VI, which is the correct decoding. So that is what I am showing here, that if this is my R, then the Hamming distance between R and VI is given by weight of EL, whereas Hamming distance between R and any other code word is given by weight of EL plus VS. Now note, EL and EL plus VS, they both belong to same coset, they are, because they have the same error pattern EL. Okay. Yes.
VJ is any another code word?
Yes. So what I am trying to say is, I am asking this question, when you receive R, what will the decoder decide in favor of? Which code word?
VI or VJ. So sir, why you use it is equal to sign?
Where?
The distance of RVI, that is equal to
the
distance of
RVI. Here? Oh, because in some cases, if your coset, if you have more than one coset which have same weight, like in our example, the last row there were three elements which has weight 2, correct? That's why I put weight less than equal to. Yes. No, it cannot. That's the point I'm trying to make. Why it cannot? Because if you go back, look at this. To minimize probability of error, error patterns most likely to happen are chosen as coset leader. And for a binary symmetric channel, what is that error pattern? An error pattern of smaller weight is more likely. So weight of EL will be always less than equal to weight of EL plus some other code word, because EL and EL plus some other code word, they are all element in the same coset. If you go back to the standard array that we have, pick up any row, what are the elements? Just look at this row, E3 plus V2, E3 plus V3, E3 plus V4, E plus E5. Now among all these cosets, we are choosing a coset E3 which has minimum weight, that is to minimize probability of error. So that is the reason weight of EL will be less than equal to weight of EL plus VS.
Not applicable on the last row.
I am sorry?
Sir, it is not applicable on the last row, in which we have three vectors of weight.
No. What still if you have two vectors of weight 2, still we chose our coset leader as one containing weight 2. We have still chosen our coset leader as error pattern of weight 2. Now if that error pattern happens and if I decode it, let's recall, how are we decoding? We have this standard array, we are first getting a receive sequence, computing the syndrome. Now that syndrome is pointing to a particular row of this standard array. Now we are saying, look, among the elements of this row, the first element is most likely error pattern. So we are saying our estimated error is the first column of this row, and we add that to the receive sequence to get back our estimated code word. That's what we are doing. So the point I'm saying is, because the way I am choosing my coset leader, so it would not happen that I have an element in the coset which has weight lower and I am not choosing it as coset leader. There can be elements of same weight. Okay, that's why I put this less than equal to. So if this happens, what are you going to decide in favor of? Because the distance between R and VI is less than equal to distance of R and VJ, you are going to decide in favor of VI.
The last line.
Which one?
I mean, the whole sentence is clear, but the last.
You mean this one?
Yes.
Okay, this fall.
WEL less than.
Okay, so what is WEL? WEL is nothing but this. Okay, and what is this? This is this. So it follows that this is equal to this. Okay, so hence, if the coset leader is chosen to have the minimum weight in its coset, then the decoding of based on standard array is the maximum likelihood decoder. And that explains the question you asked earlier, that can we choose any other error pattern? Technically, yes, but we are not going to do that, because we are going to choose the minimum weight pattern as our coset leader. Okay, so to summarize what we have, we first compute the syndrome. Now that syndrome will point to a particular row of the standard array. We choose the coset leader of that row as our likely error pattern, and we add that to the receive sequence to get back our estimated code word. So we can also implement this syndrome decoding as a table lookup, because each syndrome will point to a particular row, and corresponding to that, there is a coset leader. Now, syndrome decoding can be used to perform a combination of error correction and error detection. What do I mean by this? That syndrome decoding can be used for a combination of error correction and error detection. No, so
we can locate the errors and we can correct them.
Okay, let's look at what we did. What we did was each syndrome pointing to a particular row, and we said its coset leader is most likely error pattern, and we added that and did the decoding. Now come back to the row which all of you have been pointing in our example. Row number 8. If I do that, what's going to happen? Now there are also other weight 2 error patterns which are equally likely to happen. If I try to do error correction, there will be 2/3 of times I will make mistake, at least, because there are 3 error patterns of weight 2. Any one of them is equally likely. So what I can do is, instead of trying to correct all errors by saying that whenever the syndrome is pointing to a particular row, I will always pick up the coset leader as the error pattern. Why don't I do this? For some rows, I will do the error correction. But in some rows, I will, whenever the syndrome is pointing to those rows, I will say, look, I know there's an error because syndrome is non-zero. But then I don't know what the error is. Like, for example, in our example, this example that we had, doesn't it make more sense if the syndrome is pointing here, rather than choosing this as my most likely error pattern, if I just say error detected, period. I don't know what the error is, error detected. And for the other rows, because these are all coset leaders, there's only one such coset with that particular weight, whenever the syndrome is pointing to these rows, I will do error correction. So whenever the syndrome is pointing to any of these rows, I will choose this coset leader as the most likely error pattern and add it to the receive sequence. So what am I doing is, I am doing a combination of error correction and error detection. So whenever the syndrome is pointing to these rows, I am doing error correction. Whenever the syndrome is pointing to this row, I am doing error detection. So that's what I meant, combination of error correction and error detection. Now, what are the so what I said was, you can do three things. You can always do error correction. When you do always error correction, what will you do? Whichever row the syndrome is pointing to, you will choose the first element as coset leader and estimate. That is error correction, only error correction. I can do error detection. What is error detection? It's at the other extreme. Whenever the syndrome points to non-zero, that means these elements, all these elements, this and this elements, these elements. Whenever the syndrome points to any of this row other than the first row, I say error detected. That's the other extreme. In between could be combination of error correction and error detection. So I am doing error correction, I am doing error correction when the syndrome is pointing to these, but I am doing error detection when it's pointing to the eighth row. So that's what I meant when I said syndrome decoding can be used to perform a combination of error correction and error detection. Is that clear? Okay. So I repeat what I said earlier. Coset leaders corresponding to lowest weight patterns are used for error correction. So if I have in a coset only one error pattern which is the lowest weight, then I'll go for error correction because that's the most likely error pattern for a binary symmetric channel. Now syndrome corresponding to higher weight or less likely error patterns can be used for detected error rather than correction. So this is the 6-3 code for which I drew the syndrome. These are the correctable error patterns. Why these are correctable error patterns? Because these are the coset leader. Now I said correctable error patterns, so let's look at these numbers. So these were, remember this is 6-3 code, so there are total 64 possible receive sequence. Now I am saying 7 of them are correctable error patterns, 8 of them are detectable error patterns, and 49 of them are undetected error patterns. Now if you have understood this lecture, you help me identify which are these code words. So these were row 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you have row 5, 6, 7, 8.
All the error detection correction.
I'm sorry? Which is not clear?
The last one.
You mean simultaneous error correction and detection? So
before counting we were
not. Okay. So what we were saying was, we were saying this, right? Syndrome decoding can be used for combination of error correction and error detection. Now, how do you use syndrome for decoding? What we do is, whenever a syndrome points to a particular coset, we choose the coset leader as our likely error pattern and we add it to the receive sequence to get back our original code word. That's how you do syndrome decoding for error correction. Is that clear? Okay. Now how do we use syndrome for error detection? We compute the syndrome and the syndrome is non-zero, then it's error correction, error detection. So if I want to do error detection, so syndrome corresponds, so whenever the syndrome is pointed to any of these rows, that is error detection. Whenever I am using this coset leader for error correction, that means I am using this coset leader as the likely error pattern, I am doing error correction. Now what is combination of this? Combination of this would be when the syndrome is pointing to few rows, I will do error correction. But for remaining, I will do error detection. So for example, look at this case. For all weight 1 patterns, these are the smallest weight patterns in the same coset. If you look at this particular coset, there is no other element of weight 1. So it makes sense for me, when the syndrome is pointing to this particular coset, I go for error correction. But that's not the case here. If you look here, this is weight 2 pattern, this is weight 2 pattern, this is weight 2 pattern. So when the syndrome is pointing to this particular coset, what I'm saying is, I won't do error correction. What is error correction in this case? Choosing this as the likely error pattern and adding it to the receive sequence. Correct? What I'm saying is, if the syndrome is pointing to this particular row, I would not go for error correction. I know there's an error. Why I know there's an error? Because the syndrome corresponding to this is non-zero. So I know there's an error. But why I'm not going for error correction? Because there are other patterns of weight 2 which are equally likely to happen as the coset leader. Like this coset leader has once in this location, this has once in this location, this has once in this location. So these patterns are equally likely to happen, and that is why when my syndrome is pointing to this particular row, I am not going for error correction. I am going for error detection. So now I have used my syndrome for both error correction and detection. When the syndrome is pointing to these rows, I am doing error correction. When the syndrome is pointing to the last row, I am doing error detection. Now what are the two other extremes? Two other extremes is, I do only error correction. What is error correction? So whenever the syndrome is pointing to any particular coset, I choose the coset leader as the likely pattern. That is the other extreme. The other extreme is, I do only error detection. So whenever the syndrome is non-zero, I say error has occurred. That's it. So let's just look at now what are the correctable error patterns. So what are the correctable error patterns? So these error patterns have to be coset leader, and in those cosets, there should not be any other error pattern of same weight. So which are the coset error pattern? This one, this, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. These 7 are correctable error pattern. Of course, that includes a pattern which is no error. I just put it in correctable error pattern. Now, what are the detectable error patterns? The last row, because whenever the syndrome is pointing to the last row, I say give up. I know there's an error, but I am not sure what is that error. Okay? And what are these undetectable errors? So in these 7 rows, I am choosing the coset leader as the likely error pattern. But that doesn't mean that other errors cannot happen. What if error pattern was this? If the error pattern was 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, I would have still chosen, this all 0 as my likely error pattern. Are you getting my point? So for the first 7 rows, columns 2 to 8, those are my undetected error. Why? Because actually the error that happened is not the smallest weight error. Some higher weight error has occurred. But since I have already decided in favor of going for the smallest weight error, I make an error. So those are your 49 undetected error. And these are your 64 possible. No, these are undetected. Why is undetected? So look at this example. Let's look at, let's say, you transmit some code word. Let's say V2. You transmitted V2. So you transmitted 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0. Okay. And let's say the error pattern was this one, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. Okay. Then what are you going to receive? You are going to receive 1, 1, 0, 1. Just write it down. You will receive, can you just speak out? You will receive 1, 1, 0, 1, then 1, which one? 0. So first is 0 plus 1, that is 1, second is 1 plus 0, that is 1, third is 1 plus 1, that is 0, and then 1 plus 0, that is 1, 0 plus 1, that is 1, yeah. So this is what you receive. Now if you receive this, what is the syndrome? This is a valid code word, V5, okay. So what will be the syndrome? 0. If syndrome is 0, what will you think?
No error.
No error. You will assume that your this thing is, because you will assume that this is, because no error will point to this particular row, and you will take that no error has occurred. So you will detect as if no error has occurred. But see what has happened. Actually, an higher weight error has occurred. But you are not able to detect it. Why? Because you have already decided in favor of going for, because this error pattern is much less likely to happen than this. Okay. So this concludes our discussion on the standard array decoding. Now I have few questions for you. What are, okay, sure.
Sir, is there any mathematical representation to find out how many number of errors you can calculate?
Okay, so that's the flexibility you have, in the sense, as you can see, depending on, so you have X number of syndromes, then you can use all of them for error correction, or you can use some of them for error correction, some for error detection, or you can use all for error detection. So that's in your hand, basically. Like, and of course that depends on, because number of syndromes depends on n minus k, so that depends on number of parity bits that you have. Okay. Now, tell me some advantage or disadvantage. You have seen this standard array decoding, right? Give me some advantage or disadvantage of this. Exactly. The disadvantage is, this is not a practical scheme for, you see, this was a very toy example. I had n equal to 6, I had k equal to 3. What is n is 1000? Are you going to enumerate, or even better, 10,000, 100,000? Are you going to enumerate so many code words? So this, the complexity of this scheme is exponential as n increases, basically, right? This is another problem with this scheme. We have not used any property other than linearity. So this is a very general method. You could technically use, if you design some code, you can actually use some property of the code construction to simplify your decoding strategy. This decoding strategy is very general, can be applied to any codes, correct? But we have not made use of any property of the code construction. So this is a very general method. So when in tomorrow's class, when we'll study some classes of linear, some examples of linear block codes, then you'll see they have much simpler decoder, because we are using some property of the code to decode our basically code. Okay.